Anybody who does a lot of videos in general, and a lot of vlogs in specific, is bound to develop their own style. When it comes to the different vlogging styles of the people here, it's like different flavors, and I enjoy seeing the variety. Some styles, however, are more rancorous than others. Some styles tend to grate at your mind a little. And the challenge with those styles is perhaps to ask yourself what content is there. If you can get beyond a person's delivery, you know, many comedians depend upon the way a joke is told, you know. There's perhaps a finite amount of jokes which circulate through the ethosphere of comedy, and they are adapted and Frankensteined. Words are replaced, but it's essentially the same thing. So in that respect, it's the way that you convey this feeling, this idea, this impression that you have that really counts for half of what you're doing, you know? A good comedian can tell a mediocre joke and have it go over really well. So when you're doing vlogs, I think your style is interwoven. You know, once you've done it a long time, your style is interwoven. Your delivery and what you are saying is just in tune. You know, you hit the tuning fork and it's there with your content. Many times here, you'll see people whose delivery style is mistaken for their content, especially with the harsher, more abrasive delivery styles. And that's perhaps when you're treading on the thinner ice of interpreting and even watching, understanding, enjoying a video. There are some people whose style I don't like. It's not like, not like I can say I've never met a vlogger I didn't like, you know, it was that old line. But I do try, even in the cases where I don't necessarily agree with the style it's taken. Some people have ways of using the language that's grating to my ear. But when I get to know them as a person, it tends to melt away. You know, just look at the friends that you have, you know. Everybody's flawed. We're all broken little mechanisms bumping into each other in a crazy little rat race here. But once you get to know what's inside, you know, then that's what makes the difference. And some people are not the best at being judges of character. And there's a philosophy that says you shouldn't judge anything, you know, lest ye be judged. So, looking for the heart of the vlog is really important. A lot of times, and Ogier made a very good observation as it pertained to Tometo, right? They noticed that activity on the site is down, so blammo, here comes this paid vlogging carrot that they want to dangle in front of us. And ooh, all sorts of people talk about this imaginary carrot. Well, they notice the activity on the site is dropping again, and blammo, vlog week. And then they think, why not pile it on, right? So there's this response to Inmendum, who's been here for a while, and it's not like Paul is in the habit of responding to Inmendum, but suddenly here it comes, and again, and again, and again, and he does one that says, okay, Argent, this is the last one I'm doing for a week, and then a few hours later, he does several more. So, he probably looked at the view count, right? I had a thought of rigging his view count so it was like 20,000 views or something and seeing what would happen. That's Grifter's job, though. So, the way Paul would present his vids. And I know I am at a severe disadvantage. He is a YouTube guy. Lots of people know him from YouTube. Well, speaking as someone who hasn't seen a single Paul vid on YouTube and only knows him from vlogger heads, he does tend to think like a businessman in everything that he does. I have seen some videos that seem to be comedy, but when it comes to community messages, these PSAs, these little attacks, not just on Unmendum, but Broken Mech too, and that's what gets me, you know? Broken Mech is one of the more polite people that I've seen, thoughtful, and the attack that Paul did, I think, roused something in a lot of the responses that Broken Mech gave were like, fuck you to that. So, devolution, right? the de-evolution of vlogging as respectful communication. Was it really started by Unmendum? I don't think so. I think there's enough content in there to give the high, holy absolution to the delivery. But when it comes to, you know, something like an administration doing that kind of an attack, you know, it's one thing for an admin to do a video saying, I disagree with you, you know, I don't like what you're saying, I don't think it's going to work. And it's another thing to, you know, have an admin make up phony names for you and call you crazy and stuff like that. I just think it was a line that was crossed, and I don't even think Paul crossed it out of any kind of hatred. You know, I think whatever he generated in his video was done as a businessman, was done to get attention, was done to get views. And I tend to dismiss such content as just that. So, I can't say I've watched all of Paul's videos. I have no point commenting to this length on it, so I will cease. Coming back to a person's style, vlogging style, it can be completely different from how you are in real life. You could be a sheltered hermit, much like I am, and have a rather open and fluent vlogging style. Or, you could be the life of the party when you're out, and just do a vlog every now and then, you know, and you're not sure what to say. Sort of a contrast there that's rather amusing. What does it say about people's psyches, you know? If you look at the formative years, well, at least according to Harry Stack Sullivan or Eric Erickson, you look into sociology standpoint of it, you could say that maybe between the ages of 7 and 9, or stretch it a little more, 7 and 13, things happen to people which forms a great amount of their individuality, the impressions they take of the world, and in order for that to change, it has to be a rather substantive environmental change which ensues to really alter those patterns, you know, those habits, those ways of thinking, and the social norms and mores of the culture you might be in, even if that culture is going from East Coast to Midwest, you know, it's still going to have an effect on you, no matter what age you are. It'll have more of an effect the more impressionable you are, the younger you are. And keeping your mind open also has a downside. You know, you're more susceptible. That open slate can bear marks, you know. So it affects the way that you're going to present yourself to the people you want to talk to here. And keeping it in mind is something that perhaps is confusing, you know. A lot of the time, you'll click on a video. You like the title, you like the person, you like the picture, you like the description, whatever. And you are not in any kind of an evaluative mode. You know, you have, I'm going to Suzuki here, you have Zen mind and you have beginner's mind, right? So you click on a video, and let's say you have something in between, and you're just ready to see what's there. A lot of times, the roadblocks, the speed bumps that come up, and I'm not speaking in player smoothness, speaking in the delivery, in the format, in the context, in the way it's presented, a lot of the times, the blocks that come up when you're trying to really connect with somebody and see what they have to say are these little associative characteristic things that have to do with the person's style. And they could have the grandest of ideas, you know? to be talking about world peace and feeding the hungry and equitable socioeconomic system, but if their delivery is either so tuned that they're just striking this chord that's annoying to some and pleasing to others, or their delivery is, say, not quite the polished thing that they want, and they're half thinking about something else, you know? How many of us have done a vlog where halfway there in the back of our mind we're thinking about the bills, we're thinking about the errands, you know, we're thinking about what we have to do when we turn the camera off. So, the vlog zone is a little place in your mind, just like the man cave I have here, is a concentrator, right? It helps me to think. It's just me. The place is, you know, small enough so that it's not really comfortable for anybody else, just me. Just the landing of a small set of stairs here. Go down one way, I'm at the porch. Go up the other way, I'm opening the door to a sink and a toilet and a microwave. But here, in this little spot with a window that's good light and all that, I can really have an Indonesian clove cigarette and try to think about the way I want to say things and the way I want to present things. And Ogier asked me in my Why I Like in Mendham video, one of the many things he brought up, very good points, I really like this guy. One of the things he asked me was, well, if you think his delivery is valid, and if you think his dismissal of others, you know, just to move on to the point that he has to make, is effective, why don't you adopt it? Well, I told him, perhaps he's being facetious and all that. Now, style is an individual thing, you know, and what's effective for some is unbearable for others. There's lots of things that people like to do that I could not do myself, even though I acknowledge them is highly effective. I can't be friendly right off the bat, even though it really, really helps, you know. If I'm in a crowd, if I'm in a room, I just can't, you know, without feeling as if the bullshit wave is overcoming me and I'm putting on this facade, you know. And unless I consciously make the effort to bullshit, I just can't open up and be warm and friendly to relative strangers. And I don't consider you guys strangers anymore. So, it's individual, you know. And the styles that we convey to the people that we talk to, the flavors that we're able to present, are uniquely our own. If we let others influence the way we want to vlog, that is pretty much a tragedy. So, just as with writing, you have to find your own voice. I was once asked to teach a writing class at a community college. I had a landlord at the time whose friend was, a dean or principal or whatever the hell you have over there. I'm not too concerned about the administrative substructure. But he said that he'd shown one of my books, and they talked a bit, and I should come down. And I thought about it, you know. I thought, geez, I'm fucking going up and teach some writing class in college. Who the fuck am I to tell people how to write? You know? You maybe I'm saving them from some other dastardly fuck. I should have looked at it that way. But the way I looked at it at the time was, I have to struggle to be as humble as I'd like to be. And oftentimes I fail, but I try to be a pretty damn humble person. And I use that in conjunction with this craziness that I have. Because if you don't have both, if you're crazy and arrogant, you're just an asshole. And if you're humble but you don't have that spark of craziness, well, you're just a little meek, you know? You need the craziness, you need the humble. It's like the car and the gas. And I could live my whole life and not find the right admixture of those things. So I just felt that I was coming off as phony. Why should I teach as a big fucking phony? It's not like I have some massively popular book out there. All of my 25 books out there have pretty much no audience. Not to say for the unpublished stuff, no, not even mention that. So yeah. I'm taking this all back around to the point of vlogging and presentation and sharing and style. The subject of style, I think, is one of the undercurrents that have come up recently. And objectionable styles, right? Styles where you're harsh, you're grating, you're abusive. Those come into question. And there are some people who I greatly respect who can't get past that style, who feel that the style is such an affront that it pretty much represents what the person is. Insult comics would never make a dime if they had an audience full of people who felt that their style was just a literal representation of who they were as persons. It's not the case. You know, the style is a conveyance method. When you want to deliver something, you put a package on it if you want to make it look nice. And some packages are just like Christmas presents, you know? Little colorful pictures and images and happiness and bows and ribbons and all that shit. And some of them are just black, shiny wrappers with maybe a streak of red velvet across it or some crazy shit like that. And you look at it, and you're not sure if it's a present from a friend or a warning from the mafia. You know what I'm saying? And that has to do with people's choice of delivery. And is it a choice, right? Is the way you vlog your choice, or is it an extension of who you are? Is it a culmination of your experiences? Is it a focusing point for expressing yourself? Style is a funny thing, you know? For those who are starting off in the writing industry, they're often told to consult manuals of style. And my response to that is just read a lot of books. Read a lot of books from authors that you like. And there's your style right there. So, vlogging is a shared community experience, you know? If I have a lot of people, thankfully, I have a decent amount of friends who I like to watch, and I'm able to benefit and to learn not only from their content, but also from their style. You know, it's like being inspired by the theme of a movie. You know, when I was a kid, I would watch a movie, I would go to the theater and see Rocky, and I'd come out and I'd feel uplifted, you know, in that very childish sense. Well, if I can hold that child and preserve it a little bit and feel the same fucking inspiration when somebody does a passionate vlog, well, no way in hell should they be ridiculed. No way in hell should they be censored. You want to have something in the terms of service that says, obviously, there's something there. You can't direct attacks on other members and stuff like that. And you walk the line. And making exceptions for people is a dubious enterprise. But I'm not sure that the rigidity that some people would like there to be in something such as the TOS is the best thing. And perhaps, as evidenced by recent behavior, the administration also feels the same way about that precise rigidity not exactly being the best thing when it comes to TOS. Just as we vlog individually, perhaps when it comes to community offenses, they could be judged on an individual basis, because if Howard Stern does a radio broadcast, obviously you're going to have a group of people who say that it's always offensive. You know, no matter what broadcast it is, even if it's one of his milder ones, people will just stand on principle. And so instead of lumping it all and saying, well, it's all out, perhaps the individual thing. And I got to stand with the side of the artist if they want to say, screw it, you know, you censor some of my stuff, well, it's just the same as censoring part of my creation, and I don't want to stand for it, and whatever they want to do, you know. Vloggerhead should be about the artist, should be about the inner voice of the vlogger, and I don't mean to dictate. I don't mean to say that I'm calling anybody out or talking down to anyone or any shit like that. I'm just speaking to you as a friend and sharing my opinions and doing a totally unedited vlog the way ideally I would like all of my vlogs to be, but sometimes camera troubles and sometimes stuff that slips out that, you know, it's like, oh shit, they wanted me to keep that private. You know, then I'll have to edit. But just being here, you know, and sharing it with you is a cumulative experience. And we go on and we build, and we're able to play off each other, you know, the symphony of this whole thing that's going on. I don't think it needs intentional tweaking. I don't think it needs that kind of executive tampering that occurs when, say, you know, I'm just naming, say, administration says, oh, our vlog numbers are dropping. What gimmick can we come up with? Let's do paid vlogging as a gimmick to get some people drooling and talking about it, you know? I really think it's a disservice to the community. Let the community have a lull, okay? I know it's not me paying the bills, but from what I understand, the bills are like under $100 a month, right? Well, take $20 and say, we're going to have a little bit of a lull, and let's see how it regenerates. Let's see how it picks up again, you know? You don't have to go in and start delivering fucking CPR with all these synthetically fabricated, manufactured scenarios. But it's your style, right? Sometimes it's your style. It's all part of the experiment.